chose a cloud to symbolize himself as a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. He kept drawing this cloud all around the edges of his chart to show you how that everything on the chart abides within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Now Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive it from this pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form to write within himself as Elohim. This is the word for son, a superincorporeal being having the shape and form of a man but without flesh and blood. Now this form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested into a physical body and walked the earth in his Yahshua Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now there's only one name given unto salvation, and we must all know this name. So the simple yet intelligent question we must all ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also, in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. We call it divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of Egypt, he called Moses to top Mount Sinai and showed him this tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. The pattern consists of the most holy place, and the court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. We also go back to prove how that everything in the universe operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. Our 10 constitutional aims and objectives are as follows. First is to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as he really is and actually exists. Second, to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity and Yahshua Messiah, without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third, to investigate the unexplained spirit law or the so-called law of nature and the powers latent in man. Fourth, to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical occult sciences. Fifth, to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth, to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh, to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons offering the mystery of being on earth through the dispensation of time. Eight, to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered unto the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth, to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved save in the name of Yahshua Messiah. And tenth, to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the New York State. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is speak true. This morning we'll have a prayer by Noreen McClendon and scripture, Isaiah the 46th chapter by Katrina Jones.
Good morning, class. Let us all bow in our hearts and minds and give thanks to God for another opportunity to gather together and learn something about his purpose and his plan and his operation within us. And let us pray that we feel the spirit of him moving within us and that something be said to edify the body. And we ask all these things in his son's name, Yahshua Messiah, let us all say.
Hallelujah.
I'll be reading from the Holy Name Bible containing the Holy, the Holy Bible containing the Holy New Testament. Revised by the late A.B. Trainer, the Scripture Research Association. That's Isaiah, the 46th chapter. Bell bowed down. Nebo stupid. Their idols were upon the beast and upon the calf. Their carriages were heavy loaded. They are burdened to worry to the worried beast. They stoop, they bow down together. They could not deliver the burden, but themselves are brought into captivity. Hearken unto me, O house of Jacob, and all the remnant of the house of Israel, which are born by me from my belly, which are carried from my womb. And even to your old age I am he, and even to hoar hairs will I carry you. I have made and I will bear, even I will carry and will deliver you. To whom will you liken me and make me equal and compare me that we may be like? They lavish gold out of the bag and weigh silver in the balance. And they hire a goldsmith and he maketh an idol. They fall down, yea, they worship. They bear him upon the shoulder, they carry him and set him in his place, and he standeth. From his place shall he not remove. Yea, one shall cry unto him, yet cannot he not answer, nor save him out of his trouble. Remember this and take it to heart. Bring it again to mind, O ye transgressors. Remember the former things of old, for I am El, and there is none else. I am Elohim, and there is none like thee. Declaring the end from the beginning, and from ancient times the things that are not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand, and I will do all my pleasure. Calling the evil from the east, the man that executed my counsel from a far country. Yea, I have spoken it, I will also bring it to pass. I have purposed it, I will also do it. Hearken unto me, ye stout-hearted that are far from righteousness. I will bring my righteousness, it shall not be afar off, and my salvation shall not tarry. I will place salvation in Zion for Israel my glory. I've read Isaiah, or tried to read Isaiah.
Acknowledge some visitors from our Pomona class. We have Al Chisholm and his wife Peggy and their son Antoine here with us this morning. Welcome, we're happy to have you. Our first speaker will be Al Chisholm.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Hello. I don't really know where to start, but I'm going to start. Now, first of all, I would like to thank Yahweh, my Elohim, for all the blessings, all the wisdom and knowledge that has been bestowed upon me. You know, I mean, the wisdom, intelligence, and knowledge that has been placed, the wisdom and intelligence and knowledge that the world has instilled within me, right? His love, his beauty, his justice, that has called me to, I say, to know how to love, to know how to treat my brothers and my sisters, to know how to deal with life stuff, right? The foundation, the power and strength that has taken over, that has completely revolutionized my way of thinking. You understand what I'm saying? In other words, what has happened is that I came up, I'm going to give you a little history. I came up, the young man came up in church as what we call a Baptist, right? Now my mother, father, and all of them, they were real religious type people, you know. I remember when I couldn't even go to the movies, stuff like that when I was a child, you know. My dad was a janitor, superintendent of Sunday school, president of the digging board, you name it. He was all of that. So when the doors opening, I was opening them, you know. I was there every time the church opened. But I knew that there was something wrong. I always tell this, but I can't help it. But I'm trying to get to the point, right? So now what happened as I grew up a young man, then I couldn't deal with the preacher. But I loved to hear the choir. You know? I was singing, but soon that preacher got up there, for some reason it seemed like I was just those all. You know? Now, I knew that there had to be a creator, because there could not be a creation without a creator, right? I kept that within me. I kept the custom and tradition that I had from a child that my father had taught me and brought me up in, right? right on through school, right on through service. I remember when I first got into service, I had a problem with the brothers, because they cursed and they locked out here, they do all kinds of stuff. And they didn't know how to get rid of me because they start cursing and stuff, you know, I got to get at. So, especially when they start talking about all the things with the girls and stuff, because I wasn't into that. I wasn't taught that stuff in my house. We didn't drink in my house. We didn't smoke in my house. We didn't gamble in my house. I'm talking about as a child coming up, right? Now, here I am getting introduced to all that stuff because I'm away from home. But still, I couldn't quite just get right into it. But as I got older, I grew into it because I took that first break. I got attached to this first girl, and started cursing. So here comes the time. I remember it was right somewhere when I was about maybe 19 or something like that. I started kind of like getting all the buddies and friends and stuff, being with them, because I was born mostly, right? So what they start doing little things, and I found myself doing that still. We pull up beside a car on the base, and they had brand new tires in the car, and I needed some tires in my car. It was the same kind of car, but we put it in, and jack his car up, take his tires off, and put it on my car, you know. You see, one day I said, wow. I said, what am I doing? I said, now, I know that this is not right. Right? So what I did, I kind of refrained from it, because I failed the first phase of training, because I was a jet mechanic, and you know, we had a whole lot of stuff to learn. We had a little plane from tail to the front to the tail end, right? So, anyway, I pulled away from them and got off into my studies. Then I found out that it was really simple. Because I think it was the third or fourth phase training, that was the electrical phase, that was the hardest. Guys had sit there through two or three phases, guys had passed behind, but they couldn't pass it because it was so hard. I smoothed right on through that, you know? And anyway, all those brothers, that thing, they came up with me, so they wound up going to jail, right? And so I said, well, now, and I look back on that as kind of like as a blessing, right? Now, what I still kept that within me, as that church thing, or that religious type thing, right?
Yeah.
So now, here I go. Now, all of a sudden, I couldn't take my children to church no more like I was doing, right? I found myself not being able to chastise my children the way that I was chastised. I could sit up and watch them do something else, and I'm saying to myself, wow, how come I let them get away with that? You know, I'd have been slapped up on the table or somewhere, you know, beat to death out there. But anyway, I'm watching them do things that I could, and I'm wondering to myself, how come it is that I can't chastise them like I was chastised, right? So anyway, so one Sunday, I went to church. And I had to stop off my wife, we were going to church and all that kind of stuff, you know. But then I went to take my children to Sunday school. So in the Sunday school this Sunday, that was this preaching guy there who was preaching about Jesus and the woman at the well. So he said that the preacher said that he came down with his brother and he asked the woman asked him for some water or something. He asked him for some water. Anyway, he had it all backwards. Right? Because I knew that he asked them for water. Because you were just sitting there at the well, right? I had just got through reading. So after Sunday school, I would go up to the preacher and say, Ron, I said, that ain't the way it is. He said, look, you don't tell me how to teach this thing. I preach it the way I want to preach it. Right? And boy, that hurt me. So guess what? I didn't bother people going to Sunday school and taking no Sunday school no more. Because I knew within myself that a preacher, a minister had a heavy burden on his shoulder. You know, because if I'm preaching my congregation wrong or teaching them wrong, I'm responsible for them. They're like my
right.
sheep.
That's right.
You know what I'm saying? And so I said, wow. And I said, God, that's all I knew at that time. I said, please, don't make me no preacher. Right? And that stayed with me. Right? So now, every time, so I come on out of church, right? So one time I was sitting on the curb, I didn't bring back, I kept my little pocket Bible with me, right? I wore out pockets with books, the Bible stuff. But every time I'd open it, I didn't know how to read it or where to read it. So what I would do, I would just open it, and once I opened it, I would read, right? Okay, so one day I was working with this company in Burbank. I was in a tuning doctorate, so you know, you didn't have too many blacks off of there, so they were kind of like prejudiced when you know, I talked to them and stuff. So I sat down on the curb, and I just opened up my book, and opened up the Revelation that said, come out of her, my people, and I will receive you, to be not partaker of her sins, and receive of her plagues. Then Sister Thompson said, well, see, that's your church. I said, what? Well, that scared me. It honestly scared me. I took the Bible clothes and put it in my pocket. You know, it got to me, right? So, then we had a big layoff at the plant. So I went to work at another company as a tool that I make with these people, that they're making child furniture manufacturing. It was in Mustang, that's somewhere. Anyway, so these guys saw me at lunchtime sitting there reading my Bible. So they came up, they said, now, you say you have to read the Bible. He said, do you understand what you're reading? I said, well, pretty much. He said, did you know you're not going to get baptized and have the Last Supper and the heaven and all that stuff? I said, what? Hey, I tell you what, we are going to prove it to you. So tomorrow at lunchtime, we'll meet you right here, and we're going to prove it. I said, oh, okay. That stayed on my mind all that day, all that night, right? The next day, lunchtime, you know what I did? I went out there and said, my car need my lunch. I went to my lunch. Those boys, see, I'm saying, oh, that ain't nothing but the devil, right? So, this guy came up and says, Al, he says, the owner want to talk to you, right? And I said, okay. So he came down and he told me that I had made this die wrong, right? To manufacture this chair. I said, well, that's my print that you gave me, right? I made it according to you, your instructions, right? And your specifications, right? And he says, well, anyway, that is the way that I want it, right? So now, I'm pretty sure that my supervisor did something, a change of plan, some kind of way, that caused it to come out the way that it did. But guess what? I don't care how it come out. It still called me to get laid off, right? So I only worked out for about 2 weeks. But I knew they could get no more. They came to me, right? Okay, so on this other job that I want to work on, there's another guy came up to me. I never forget the name, Rio Watson. Right? He came to me, he says, hey, I see you like to read the Bible. I said, yeah. And then he starts telling me about, I was supposed to get baptized and all this stuff, right? And I said, wait a minute. But he didn't leave me alone. He came to me every day. Look, he always coming to me. Always coming to me, right? And so he said, I tell you what. So I started listening to him, right? He said, okay, I tell you what. Now, I go to this class. We had on Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays, I think it was this Sunday, right? And it was at 10:40 South Graham. He says, why don't you come down and just check it out? That's all I ask you to do, right? I said, okay. I came home last night and got ready to go to class, but I couldn't go. I'm like, this class, man, I've been planning to come down here for a long time, and I ain't never been able to get here. We closed up about 2 or 3 weeks, a couple of Sundays at Pomona over there. And on Sunday, they have a class, right? I said, hey, this will be a good time to go down to jail, right? Check it out, right? Guess what? When time comes, I just couldn't do it. I guess it took the right time and the right place in order to make that move, right?
Right.
So anyway, so I couldn't go to class. So Rio said, well, I tell you what, I'm going to come get you. I said, okay. If you come get me, I'll go. So I got ready, came home, got ready for work, because we worked about an hour or something over that time. And so I was sitting there, I said, he ain't going to show up, because I ain't supposed to go down there for water, I can go myself, right? I sit down, and all of a sudden, here he comes, boo-boo, right? I said, hey, he made it. You know, all the time I was headed for going out there, I said, something's going to happen. We ain't going to go down, but I'm going to be going out of this place, right? So we went on down and ain't nothing happened, right? I sit there, I looked at the charts and stuff around that room, and I heard enough to bring me back again, mm-hmm. Right? Mm-hmm. So he come got me on another occasion. Now when that's, and once I come on that second time, I saw things, I said, wow, you know? I don't know if it was a name. I can't tell you what it was that caught my attention, not to this day, right? But anyway, I started coming down there, and after a while, I started coming on my own, right? And so, those seats were hard that time. We didn't have those. We didn't have no microphone and nothing like that, right? So that was this little guy, AC Killer. So he would get on the floor and he would teach, right? He'd learn what we have to do. Like he had a mouthful of snuff. I couldn't understand nothing the man was saying, right? But then, I said, well, but I can understand what Dr. Harris was saying, right? There weren't too many of us there now, like, who was there? I think, Snell Baker was there, Lula was there, Bud Wins, Dr. Harris, and you know, a bunch of old guys, right? So, one Sunday, it was on Friday, I wasn't going to go to class. So I got off from work, and I went home. So I stopped at the kids, right? They were moving, I was going to help them move. The doctor, they had always told us to be class, right? So, what happened is I went home, I didn't like that music for some reason, and I like all kind of music, right? So I goes to, I said, well, I'm going to go and get this paper. We had the A-Tracks at the time, right? Yeah. I done got Mr. Cates and everything, and I'm all in that class, right? So I go to the same thing, I sit down there on the edge of the bed, get my tape, right, because I had the music on sitting in the bedroom. So, I was looking through the head, and all of a sudden something knocked up my breath. I couldn't breathe in or out from my mouth, nose, nothing. And I stood up like that. I couldn't breathe, so it was like something pushed me all the way out the door of my house, all the way to the bedroom, all the way out the kitchen, on the back bed. So I got to lean over the bouncer. And I called my brother and I said, what was that? You know? And so I finally got my breath together. And I started back in the house, and the same thing happened again. And then when I come out that house, I got all the way out to the street and leaned over the hood of my truck, right? And finally caught my brother again. Well, I think I'm going to get it that time, you know. And so, some says, look, you go class. Because the doctor said, look, you be here. So because don't you miss no classes. Because you can't afford to miss my run. So every opportunity that you get, so you be here. Why? Because you're going to need this. Right? So I got myself together and I got on down to the plan. And I think that was Doc on the floor. But anyway, he said, look, you be here, class. You don't say I'm going to kill you. I said, oh. So I had no problem with going to class. No more after that. I didn't care what I was doing. I didn't care what it was. If it was time to come to class, I said, hey, you better come on, go with me. We're going to class. Or else I'll check with you when I get back. Yeah, right? And I didn't miss no more class. Right? So, here's God was on the floor one day. I was able then to kind of understand a little bit of what he was saying. Right? So, this is what he said one Sunday. He said, look, this is a school. This is not a church. So now, if you think that this is a church, or if you think that I'm saying what old Rem's saying, that's what he put it. If you think what I'm saying, what old Rem's saying out there, if you go home and turn your television on, you go home and turn your radio on, hey, listen to him. I said, because I'm not saying what he's saying. Well, we were weird at that time, right? We went home, turned our television on, and his old Rem got on TV, and he said exactly the same thing that doctor just got through saying from that floor. And I said, wow. But doctor said, he's not saying what I said, right? I said, something's got to be wrong. Right? So I said, yeah, well. I says, it's got to be me. I says, what is it that I'm missing? Right? So when I go to class next time, I sit down, and I was sitting down, I always sit up the close line if I was in the choir, you know. And so, I got on the floor that morning, and he said, now look, you sit here, and you give me your undivided attention. And he said, I'll show you this thing. Now while I'm right there, I want to say something. See, that was only two things that God really asked us to do. One was due to class. You come to class. And one thing said, pay attention. Alright? Now see, I didn't know how to pay attention. Like I didn't know how to come to class. So, here I was sitting there that Sunday. I was on the floor. And he started talking, right? And I called myself, paying attention. With all that I had. Because I knew that I was missing something. Because I remember saying exactly what he had said from the book, right? So, all of a sudden, I was like, back. Before that was anything, right with him. What's he doing? It wasn't no me and him. Well, nobody but him, right? But I was there, right? And he walked down through those ages and dispensations, and I was right there. Now, this might sound a whole lot of stuff to somebody, but I can talk what happened with me, right? Now, we'll give you an example. When Mary Magdalene came to anoint that body, he was right outside, and he was standing outside the tomb, right? She walked right past me, just like this, right? And what he did, he changed appearances so that she wouldn't recognize him, that she knew him as dead. Right? So right there, went in there, they tell him, oh, grandma said, where are they later, right? And she came with him, right, and asked him, right? And what he did, he just changed appearances. And made her know him that she, and she would put her arms around me, like, put her arms around me. He said, look, don't touch me.
Right.
Because I might get a sentence to the father. Mm-hmm. But you go on down and you tell them boys up there, that hey, I wrote just like I said I was going to do. Right? Boy, you took off, right? Yeah. What I'm saying, well, see, what I'm saying is this. Now, what he showed me was like the vision that you see here, right? He took everything. Okay, I'm going to break down right here. Because I don't want, I want to slow it down because I want you to see where I'm coming from. Because see, you here at this particular class, for some reason or another, I had a dream before I come here, all right? But, there's something, or there's got to be some of the brothers of the world here that are chosen to receive the reward of this teaching. You understand what I'm saying? Okay, now, after I came back to the state of just sitting on that seat, I said, wow. I said, my brothers and sisters, I said, they're missing it. So the first thing I want to do is jump on them, right? I want to jump on them. Because I want them, I didn't want them to miss it. I'm talking about, I'm down the door with all my brothers and sisters that we came up together. You know what I'm saying? I mean, we was a family, man. I'm talking about a family that you wouldn't believe. We had 10 brothers out there. All those down there, we was a family. And I want to say this too, right here while I'm just opening. Now see, Dr. Harris was a true brother to me. Right? Anything that I needed or my family needed in his profession, right? He was there without even thinking about it. Just like let's say if I had to run the streets, I'd run town and streets and stuff like that, preaching all over the place, right? Come on, sir. You hear what I said? Come on, sir. So anyway, the thing is, there's one of the people that said, so she called out there, said, son, said, the hell with him, someone said, I've been too good or something, right? He said, well, bring him on over here and let me check him out. Never charge my penny. Right? And in my profession, I did a whole lot of things. I prepared everything. I always looked at it like, if he can make it, I can repair it. Right? So I did a whole lot of things. I had a little mechanic shop and stuff like that. And if that was anything that I could do for one of the brothers and sisters, I did that. Right? Money? We ain't about talking about no money or nothing like that, right? We didn't even look at things on that night. We came up as a real, true family. And I loved them for that. Right to this day. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But now see what has happened is that a change came about. Right? When I saw what I saw, then I wanted to jump on my brothers and sisters. Because I said, well, you are missing it. Doc said this. He said, if you leave them alone, because I got them right where I want them. say no put down. I'm telling you what the man said to me. I got them right where I want them. You be grateful for what you have. Right? So I had to leave them alone. Right? And that was a lot of things that went on in class. Right? Now, I'm going to give you an example. Then I'm going to move on. Now, Doc got on that floor and he says this. He says, I wouldn't give a nickel for a marriage license. A dime for a divorce. He said, now if you're fortunate enough to be with some man or some woman when you come in this class, so you hang on to that with him. Right? He said, why? Because you're going to need one of them. Right? I mean, if anybody seen that, I've seen that very well. All right. Now, so he says that, husband said, you love your wife. And had it read in the scripture. And what? So you love your husband, because this is right in the eyesight of Yahweh, right? And had it read. Then he read on down the scripture, I don't know exactly what time, but he said, but this is a great
message. Yeah.
That's right. That's right. But I'm speaking concerning Joshua. And it's just thought out there.
See, you thought he was talking about being your lady, huh?
I said, wow. And guess what? You see, those things never left me. So when the situation came up about getting the papers, I didn't want to hear that. Why? Because I know what he told me. Right? Just like he told everybody else. Right? Now, can't you see what has happened? See, that the separation came about because it's the way that he had it planned. Mm-hmm. Or had it set up, right? Mm-hmm. They weren't supposed to hear what I heard. Mm-hmm. Okay. They couldn't miss a journal. See, man, you have to get no papers. Or else you're going to lose your soul. Mm-hmm. I said, what? Where you get that from? Well, so-and-so said so-and-so, I'm going to do this one. And so, I said, I'm not getting married to nobody. Because see, Doc said, we all are his bride. So you walk around with your pants and you're going to take your man, but you're all my bride. And guess what? I had adopted. He had made me see and understand that. You know? So, they said, they went to Dr. President Allen. They said, children, he's gonna cooperate. He said, he ain't gonna get married, right? He ain't get no papers, right? So he didn't come to me. He goes to Dr. Harris, right? And so Dr. Harris went to Dr. Kimball. He said, children, that children, what's it? He said, he didn't get married. No, one said, well, he said, yeah, I know. He said, well, he won't, no, well, no, he said, he's not gonna get married, right? He said, look, you tell children to leave them alone. Because already God was that same. So he come back and he told Freddie. And Freddie came back and told my little group. Because see, a whole bunch of them come in there. You know, with me, you know. So, but so one of the girls, she took it upon herself to go to Dr. Kendall, right? And said, Dr. Kendall. So now, if I live with a man and I'm not married, so wouldn't I be committing adultery or fornication? He said, of course you would. Listen, the guy she did come in and say, wow. She said, I was married to her. She said, would I be committing adultery? She didn't come to him, huh?
Right.
She come in telling him what to tell her. She already had her answer.
That's right.
You understand what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Already. He would have told me the same thing if I came to him right there. Mm-hmm. You understand what I'm saying? Well, see, those things, the separation didn't separate us as brothers, we put it like that, but kind of like as a family. Man, that's kind of hard to distinguish that. You know what I'm saying? Because see, I still love them just like I loved them before, but I can't say that with them up there like that, right? Because I'm looking at what has happened. Right? Now, here is why I believe. So I had to leave the class. Right? Because I was told to get up and get out of there. Right? Because now, if I hadn't got out of there, I'd stay there on that kid to this day, and they wouldn't have been able to get nowhere. Because see, I wasn't going to give up. I was going to stick with what I had. Right? And they wasn't going to give up. Wow. Let me see if I can help you with that. Now, you know what it says? Now look here, I want to share something. From Adam to Noah was 1,556 years long. Now listen, I got to write something. I'll never want to forget this. And they don't get away from where I'm going. See those two words? Those two words are the same thing. You know what I'm saying? Age and world are the same, but they're synonymous. See? Now, so, if an age or world is approximately 2,000 years long, we can see how the first age was short. But look what happened in the first age. I'm sure with that family now. I'm sure that when that separation comes right in that class, right? Yahweh himself, which had created him a body in the image and the likeness of his own self.
Yeah.
From the dust, like the solid, from the dust, like when you see a little wind blow up and all that thing. And then it said, it said, into his nostrils. He did what? Breathe. The breath of life. He didn't blow it in.
Right.
He made nobody got it. He said, now they have become as what? One of us. Isn't that word that will throw you if you don't know what that is? One of us would have that positive and that negative force that's manifested in that body now.
Yeah.
Right? Become as one of us, one word. Both good and evil.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah. See, that is what come all the way down from the beginning. See, I am Yahweh, and there is none else. I am Elohim, or I am God, and there is none like me.
Right.
Why? Because I have declared the end, right from the beginning,
right,
saying that my counsel,
that's right,
and it's stood all the way down, you see it all there, all the way down through the ages and dispensation, like a judge, and I will do all my pleasure. It's been him manifesting. See, when as Adam, Eve came forth from Adam. Cain came forth, then Abel came forth, right? Cain slew his brother Abel. And Abel was like what we call Yahweh himself, which is still in the spirit. But I'm going to deal with that 1 minute, okay? Now, what I want you to see is this. From Adam to Noah, right, that's his age right here. But see, that's the delivery age, right? Well, this is right here.
Next one.
This. That's a blueprint. That's it right here, right? See, he manifests himself in that body, right? Can't you see what when he got down here to Noah, right? That was Yahweh himself manifested in Noah, right?
Right.
Noah became conscious of who he was.
Right.
Yahshua was fully conscious of who he was when he was born, right? So Noah became conscious of who he was. Knowing the purpose.
That's right.
See? So what he did, he told his family that it was going to rain and flood out the earth. Wow. Oh, if I could see, keep that birth, that birth of a baby right there. See, the child is conceived in the womb. I'm gonna leave that alone right now, right? But you see what I'm saying? But see what? That child is conceived in that womb, right? See, that child, once that child is conceived in that womb, then there's no way that you can deceive that child when that child is in that womb. You see what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And see, once that child come out from that womb, see, then he says, a virgin shall conceive. Mm-hmm. And here's that virgin that was coming out of that womb, right? Shall conceive, and she shall bear a son, and his name shall be called what? Emmanuel, which means God with us. You know what I'm saying? So he's now got the concept of God. I'm talking about that child. Not got the concept of God, right? He is God, right? It says, and he, when he had that, when he get that concept of God, now, he, what he's doing, he's hooked and formed in the ways of the world by his parents. Right? And what that has done now, that has made him unconscious. And his conscience is what's going to guide him into the ways of the unrighteous, we'll put it like that. Right? Because now he knows the good and the bad, the right and the wrong, so to speak, right? And that's built up in him. And he's going on down to the earth plane. Right? He's got this God concept, which is his conscience, right? That is built up in him, right? And he's walking through the earth plane with this consciousness of what's right and what's wrong, what's good and what's bad, because of what his parents have taught him. Now, when the writer wrote this, he says, if your conscience condemn you, you just remember that Yahweh is greater than your conscience. Mm-hmm. Alright? Because see, you might do something that turned all terrible. And you swear you'll never do that no more. And turn right back around and do it again. Alright? But see, you ain't going to do that if you are conscious of who you are.
That's right.
Right. I'm trying my best.
That's
I'm
right.
trying my best to get up. Look at, now here's this child. Here's this child that's got this conscience built up. Right? Now, if we take what we've been taught in this world, we will go to the grocery store and we will buy beef, which is one of our best products, right? Meat, right? Now let's go to India and take one of those children. They've been taught that this is sacred, a cow is. So they sleep with the cow, they start sleeping in their bed, they go behind the cow, pick up his dog and fry the bacon and stuff like that, right? But they won't touch that cow. Now we go to that country, and our family start, we say, wow, says, we're going to kill this cow. We're going to live, right? Now, that ain't going to mess with your conscience.
Right.
But if they die not about it, they'll try to kill you.
Right.
But now, are they right or are we right? See, that's what you got to remember. See, we both are right. So many things, so is he. You see what I'm saying? So now, once we can see that, then now we can understand when he wrote to Jacob, have I loved? But Esau, have I hid? And they're not even born yet. Still in the womb. See where I'm coming from? So now here we are coming on down here to this point. We were separated, so to speak, right? Now, it wasn't that he was working with us no more than he worked with us with the other side, because we both his sons. Look, that's so many things I've got to be seeing what I'm talking about, because I want to bring in that Bin Laden stuff over there right now, but I can't, I'm going to work with that right now. But you got to see them two sons, right? You tell them about it, right? Okay, now, here we are, sitting up in class. So what has happened now is that we that were chosen to receive this, I say blessing, I put it like that, but fine. See, he has to separate us so that we wouldn't be bothering them and they wouldn't be bothering us while he's working with us.
Right.
Am I making sense?
Mm-hmm.
Right? Mm-hmm. You might have a plenty of problem with your child at home, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so now, he set me at home over 20 years. Revealing things. Showing me things. Putting all these little puzzles together. Lining up on line upon line. Precept upon precept. That's why I can speak the way that I'm speaking to you here today, because see, I'm talking to someone that knows the law. So you got the basics down.
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying? Yeah. I don't need to go up into that, not now.
Right.
You understand? Know we will take that and feed that kid that needs milk.
Right.
You understand what I'm saying? So now, here's what happened. He told us this. He said, now, we're in the last prophetic seconds. He said, now this thing is going to go. Now he had said that a couple of times before. This thing was coming to an end, right? But when it got right on down to this, we're going to send them boys around as well. Said one more time. And this is for the cleansing of the sanctuary. Because that's what kind of put me up. So I said, well, why do we have to go again? Right? They already went two times. Right? See, but now this is for the cleansing of the sanctuary. So guess what? That fit the pattern. So I said, oh, calling out that pocket. I'm going to send them boys, right? When they came, when the boys come back, you know what? He got on out of here. But he told us this. He said, look. He said, when I leave, he said, I'm taking mine with me. Now, Joshua said this. He said, now you down there until you've been down with the Holy Spirit on high. And he said that the Father will send the Comforter, which is the Holy Spirit. It's going to bring back your remembrance all these things that I've taught you, right? Okay, now. He said, but first I got to go away to prepare for you so that where I am, you may be also, right? So now when Doc came along, Doc said, look, when I leave, so I'm taking mine with me. Why? Because the place already prepared. You understand what I'm saying? Take mine with me. So again, so when he left, I was sitting up on the job about a couple of months or so later. I was reading the Elohim book. And I says, Yahweh, I said, now you said we was in the last part of the seconds. And so these seconds them ticked on in a minute. And these minutes them ticked on in an hour, right? And I said, ain't nothing happened yet. They ain't going nowhere. I said, what's happening? I said, got to be me in my understanding. Because I know you ain't never lied to us about nothing.
Right?
Right? That's how I was. I mean, that's my father. I love my daddy, but hey, he surpassed my daddy and that from that point, right? Mm-hmm. So I was sitting there, when I said, what happened? I said, ain't nothing happened yet. It was like he said, what? What you gonna sit up there looking for a physical nap again in a spiritual age?
Yeah.
Because I was talking about myself. I said, oh. So that opened up my understanding, right? To that, because I was out of still been here looking for him to come back and get me.
Right.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Guess what he did? He took me with him.
Hallelujah.
You understand? He took me with and been with me, and I've been, see, it was in him that now I live and move. Now what has happened? What happened? See right there?
Yeah.
See that we're in?
Mm-hmm.
See, he has translated me mm-hmm. into his kingdom.
Hallelujah.
Right? Without seeing death.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You understand that?
Mm-hmm.
I am now a participant mm-hmm. of this new right. kingdom age, the age of immortality.
That's right.
But there is no death. Right? There is no sorrow. There is no pain. There is no suffering. Right? This is where I am. But guess what? Ain't no place over there for no Alfonso. You see what I'm saying?
That's right.
See, if you are fully conscious of who you are, then you're one in him. Now is what he had. When all things shall be subdued unto Yahshua, our Savior, then he will present all things to the Father so that the Father may be all in all, and that's all.
Yeah.
Can you see that? Can you see that what happened?
Yeah.
This age was set up. Now, that. So at the end of that age of Noah, he saved his family. Caused them, all of them, to build that ark. Because he was ready, getting ready to close that age out. Right? Because of a lack of understanding. You know what I'm saying? Because of they had gotten away from being conscious mm-hmm. of who they were.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Now, I'm going to put that deal means now, right? But anyway, so what I'm saying is this. I'm speeding up a little bit. So we'll leave out a lot of things, but you got a problem, okay?
Okay.
So he took what he did, he took his family into the
house. Right.
Right? Not that those other people were lost. They just weren't supposed to get in the house.
Right.
Right? His thing alive, read back in Revelation, the men of the bodies of the sons that slept arose and came out with after his resurrection. But they cried on the altar, how long? How long will y'all wait? Yeah. How long must we wait? Right? And when you see when they picked him up, they sat down and when he come by the grave, he had his head, they made up his body. Mm-hmm. I thought they were dead. You know what I'm saying? Right. So when he took it in, he started off a new world, mm-hmm. a new age. And around 2,377 years, mm-hmm. right? Then he came in again. Manifested himself in the body as we know as Joshua, which was Yahweh himself, manifested in that body, right? See, and saved his family. From the what? 11 of them. Judas hung himself, right? 8 of them, the flesh, right? So he said, and started up a new world, which he called the age of grace. Right? And run all the way down to 1960. Right? And according to God, he said that the world ended in 1960. Right? Who was it that told us? Who was it that took that Bible and brought all this illustration out of that book and put it out there so we look at it? Right? Who was it that saved, told us about the Pope? Told us about all these names in the world. Who told us about who Joshua was? Didn't God tell us all those things? Or didn't Yahweh tell us all those things? He said what he did? He came, he took us out of that world. He took us out of this world. Right? And took us into the seventh angel sounded already. Right? See, we are translated into his kingdom. See, if you miss that, you miss the whole thing. Like you miss Joshua, you miss the whole thing. If you miss Noah, you miss the whole thing. We are now approximately 25 years over into the new age. If the age in the 1960s, but Doc said this. He said, look, you are now in a probationary period. We're just going through green the field. Right? So when he got back, he was 1976. You know that stuff did no perfection? And the six represent what? Reflection. Can you see them pull them all back together, now he's all in all, or one all in all. Guess what? And ain't nothing you gonna do with that, brother. The man is all in that stuff. He done brought the whole thing back into himself. See? And you can sit out here and be waiting for it to come if you want. Right? But it's all over, it was all over and done before we even set foot in this class. We would come be brought into this class. We would sit down and we would show how he had already declared it.
That's right.
Already prepared this to be.
That's right.
We are learning about what he did, what he has done.
Yeah.
Right? And we, if I learn that, and you sitting here just believing it and accepting it, and it's a currency for righteousness.
Mm-hmm.
You see what I'm saying?
Right.
So now, I'm gonna sit down because sometimes it gets me all waked up here. I didn't go the way that I wanted to go, but I had to go the way I had to go.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Right.
And I hope that something has been said to edify somebody. Because you know what? I didn't even have to say that. It might not be what we want. I'll just sit here and kind of caught on the thoughts. But I tried my best to keep them. Because you know what? I'm going to say this. See, To pay attention is to stay alert or stay awake, right? Because let me tell you something. You can easily, see your conscience is what's going to excuse you or accuse you.
Yeah. That's
see,
right.
So if you ain't staying alert, if you stand in tune, see you can easily drip out. You know what I'm saying? And the thing going on, and there you are trying to catch up with this with the group again, and the hostile tribes out there, and laying right there dead to get you.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? You can sit up and be arguing about this, and arguing about that, and debating about this, and debating about that. How come you can't sit there and just listen? Right? And let it be revealed to you. But look, he ain't going to allow you to miss nothing. This gospel, this is the true book. The gospel that I have presented to you today is the true gospel of the kingdom, which will cause you to be one with him. This is what opens up the door so that you might come on in there, right? See, it's the Holy Spirit that does the teaching.
That's right.
That does the preaching. And it's the word that I speak. That's what spirit is. And that's what life is, right? You can sit here and look at alcohol or children if you want. You know what I'm saying? But ain't nothing wrong with that. You got to see me before you can see me. Life is so beautiful, but there's only one life.
That's right.
You know what I'm saying? And that's the life that's within him. And if you are in him, then you are now all and all, and that's all.
Thank you very much. Good morning. As always, it's a pleasure and an honor to stand before the body of the assembly of Yahshua Messiah and testify of some of the things that Yahweh has revealed unto me. I've been knowing Al since I was about 18, 19 years old, maybe a little younger than that. And Al, Al introduced my father to this teaching. And before I get into what I want to talk to you, let's tell you a little bit about what happened. And Al's witness. My father used to drink every Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. And I ain't lying, he'll get maybe 2-3 gallons of that hard stuff, like what y'all drink? He'll start Friday, and sometimes he'll drink all by himself. Well, he'll go to work through the week. Mm-hmm. Some days he'll miss on Mondays and would not show up. And my dad had been doing this ever since I can remember. Sometime when we were little kids, he'll take off on Friday and be gone. My mother didn't know where he was, when he's coming back. You know, but when he show up on Sunday, he's drunk and broke. This happened for years. Make a long story short, I must have been about 16 when my father came to me and he started going to class. Now, I'm telling you, every Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, I'm talking about all day, all night, he'd be by himself, anybody want to come over and have a drink, they all get together and they drink Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. And they used to sometimes drink on a Friday night, they start at lunchtime, about 7:30, 8 o'clock, and they start drinking, they go on until Sunday. But when he got involved in this teaching, for some reason, I noticed after about a few months, every Sunday he was showing up to class. He'll drink Friday, he'll drink half the day on Saturday, but then he'll sober up to make the class on Sundays. And then sometimes he'll drink Friday and then we'll drink it all on Saturdays. But for 3 years, he made the class every Sunday. And at that time it was Sunday morning and then he'd go back to Sunday night. It wasn't like it is now where 3 days a week. And that day it was Wednesday, Friday, Sunday, and Sunday night, and then they had a Sunday school at that time. But let me tell you something, that place was packed. I'm talking about there was times you come to that place, it was standing room only sometimes. And then sometimes Doc would make a statement, we're going to be a special class, like on a Wednesday.
Yeah.
Those guys who work through the week, they take off work and they show up, and then Doc start teaching the same thing he's been teaching all along.
Yeah.
But what I'm trying to get you to see, my dad made a change in his life, you know, when it came to this teaching. Now, what bothered me was that, what concerned me was that, there must be something to this thing. Because my father would go to class every Sunday, they come back and talk to me about it. Well, at that time, I was into the Nation of Islam. You couldn't tell me nothing. I was one of the fruits of Islam. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I mean, I was like a soldier, whatever. And I didn't believe women could teach. And I call all white folks white, blue-eyed devils. I don't care how nice they were. Make a long story short, while I was in school, I was with the school up in Taft, California. I'm not sure if y'all know anywhere that is, but at that time, back in 1976, they ran all the black folks out of town. Because one of the brothers,
he got his white girl pregnant, and they got to drinking one day, the town folks, and they got together, and we were playing ball, that's it, you know. The next thing I know, they was chasing us everywhere. Everybody started drinking, and black folks just running. They called the National Guards, I mean, not the, the Bakersfield Police, and they were there, they helicoptered some of us out of there because they got really completely out of hand. But to make a long story short, there's this one white lady, all the black folks, every Saturday, I'm not talking about some Saturday, every Saturday she fixed breakfast. Now, you see how there's a lot of big guys in here. We would eat her out of a house and a home, you know. And this brother came to me and said, now, Joan, Elijah Muhammad had just died back in 1976. I'm not sure if you remember that.
Yeah.
He said, you tell me to tell me, and I'm going to be real blunt, he said, just like he told me. He said, you mean to tell me all us niggas go over here to this woman's house and eat her out of our house and home, you telling me that she's a white, blue-eyed devil, and she don't know how she's going to eat the next day? We would have ate her canned goods, her bread, her milk, and everything. And I mean, every single weekend. And me and my dumb self, as ignorant as I was, I said, yeah, she's still a white, blue-eyed devil. But my dad kept talking to me about this teaching. And I found myself mimicking the same things he was saying, because it made sense.
Mm-hmm.
You see? So, things that made sense, I would use what he would say and toss out the stuff that I embraced and got completely away from Islam. And when I finally came to class, they told me that Dr. Kelly was God. Now, I saw him at that time, he's kind of bent over, all messed up. And, you know, I said, you must be off your rock. You're talking about that God. Because I had no concept that Yahweh is located in the body.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But then I began to understand some things as Yahweh began to reveal some things. Now let me have 1 Corinthians 2 and 7. Because I understand that we're dealing with a mystery.
Right.
You see, and when you're dealing with a mystery, that means that something is going on, or there's something happening, but it's not quite readily understood.
Right.
Now what's happening right now in this age, or what's been happening, the mystery right now is, who am I?
Yeah.
What's dwelling in this body? Where does creation come from? What is it? How did it get here? Where are we within the scheme of time, and exactly where are we going? What is death? What is life? You see, what is spirit? What is the soul? These are the mysteries that we talk about. You see, and that's what we come down to this school to get answers to. You see, to elevate you out of the flesh. I'm talking about out of your ignorance, out of that darkness, out of that stupidity, out of that not knowing. That's what this school does. And that's why the first aim of the school is to help you find and know Yahweh as he really is and as he actually exists. Now listen, there is a you in Yahshua.
Mm-hmm.
You see, and I'm not talking about Joe Williams. I'm not talking about Chris. Mm-hmm. You see, I'm talking about Yahweh himself. Because there is no such thing as a you and a Yahweh.
That's
you
right.
See, and we'll get to that in a minute. Now let's read.
1 Corinthians 2 and 7.
Now this is the Apostle Paul talking. You see, and he's talking in this present kingdom age. Now he was talking to those Corinthians. Now Corinth was a place like Las Vegas. I'm talking about those people, they had a lot of money and they loved the party. You see, and he had just preached to these people and there was like a dissension in the church. But this is what he said to them. Read on.
But we speak the wisdom of Yahweh hidden in a mystery.
Now Paul said we speak the wisdom of Yahweh that is hidden in a mystery. Now God told us that Yahweh purposed the purpose within himself. You see, and when he purposed a purpose within himself, listen, he also set that purpose in motion.
Mm-hmm.
Now Yahweh is both masculine and feminine within himself. When he desires to go outside of himself to create or to procreate. You see, he is made up of these nine principal attributes of divine intelligence, wisdom and knowledge, love, duty, justice, foundation, power, and strength. That is not only, that's not only what he is, but he is the source of these attributes. And it is Yahweh himself who is both masculine and feminine. He is the parent substance. You see, and encouched. I'm talking about in this cloud here is Yahweh Elohim himself. Not in this state condition. You see, because in this state, he is in a chaotic state. You see, and being in a chaotic state, I'm talking about in pure spirit. This is a field of infinite possibilities. You see, pure creativity. You see, in other words, what I'm trying to get you to see, everything is happening in this state, what Yahweh declared. Now in that he purposed a purpose within himself. You see, not only did he purpose it, he conceived it, he declared it, and then he became. Now when he take on shape and form, what you see here is an execution of his purpose. But the mystery is still here within Yahweh. But when he set it in motion, you see, what he's doing, Yahweh is hiding himself from himself.
That's right.
You see, but he's going to reveal himself to himself.
Right.
You see, and what he does is this. He cloaks himself with a veil. What are you talking about? With the creation.
Right.
With light. With water. With vegetation. You see, so that you might see and understand Yahweh as he really is and actually exists. That's why the first thing to help you find and know Yahweh as he really is and as he actually exists. You saw in you.
Right.
You see? Now let's read on. Now we're dealing with a mystery. Read.
Which Yahweh hath ordained before the ages unto our glory.
Listen, it was ordained way back here. Matter of fact, how does that read in King James Version?
But we speak the wisdom of Yahweh in mystery, even the hidden wisdom, which Yahweh ordained before the world unto our glory.
Well, what I really wanted was this. Hold it right there and go to Hebrews. First chapter, 11th chapter, and read on down. And read out the King James Version where it talks about how the ages were framed. Hebrews 11 and 1. Read on.
Hebrews
11
and
1. Mm-hmm. Same man. Same man talking. Read on.
Now faith is the substance of things hoped for.
Read on.
The evidence of things not seen.
Read on.
For by it the elders obtained a good report.
Read.
Through faith we understand that the worlds were framed.
Now look, it says by faith that the world or the ages were framed.
Uh-huh.
You see, now what are you talking about? You see, Yahweh, see this is the creative age where there is no time. And everything divided within the realm of eternity, where time begins and ends within the realm of eternity. You see, but with the fall of Adam, then he set, you see, that purpose in motion, I'm talking about in the flesh, because there's a coming down or there's a descent. You see, so when he set up time with Adam, and you can see right here, as Adam is coming out of that garden, you see, those two sons, you see, are coming right on out together. Because see, this here, like Al said, is Yahweh, you see, manifested in that body. Or he just stepped in that body, or he just breathed the breath of life in that man, you see, or he just got in him, you see. And as he's coming out of that garden, you see, those two sons are coming down together. So now Yahweh is setting up time with the man. You see, because we measure time by gauging the sun. You see, so those two sons are coming down together. He's coming down operating in flesh. Now listen, folks. As he set up time, he also entered that age with Noah. You see, and that age lasted for 1656 years. So now that age is framed.
Right.
You see, then he closed that age and opened up the next age. You follow me? Mm-hmm. You see, and then that's the post-Luminian age, which lasted for 2377 years. You see, and it ended right here at the cross. Mm-hmm. You see, now that age is framed. You see, so you can see how the ages are framed.
Mm-hmm.
You see, according to Yahweh's purpose and whereby he ordained that right back there in the realm of eternity.
That's right.
You follow me? Let's read.
Through faith we understand.
That's good enough. Go back over to Corinthians, because I got to go.
Which none of the rulers of this age.
Now listen, in this present kingdom age is where you are now. You have access, you see, to the kingdom, you see, of Yahshua the Messiah. In other words, if there is a mystery, you can know it right now.
That's right, hallelujah.
You see, if you want to know what's operating in you, you can know it right now. Now prior to that, you didn't know nothing. Or even if you ain't thought you did, but it wasn't until the day of Pentecost and the dispensing of grace. What are you talking about? Divine intelligence, wisdom and knowledge, love, duty, justice, foundation, power, strength, and the power of the resurrection.
Right.
Now you can know that in this age. And in this age, you have access to Yahshua the Messiah. I'm talking about daily, 24/7. Read on.
For have they known it,
read,
they would not have crucified
him. See, had they known who this man was, they wouldn't have given him to crucify.
Right.
He ain't walking with no head on his head.
Right.
You follow me? Read on.
But as it is written,
read on.
I have not.
Y'all know how it is. Now, there's some big shots walking around, right?
Yeah.
Y'all know what I'm talking about. And you know how, I'm gonna take a little blood to that. And I ain't never been to prison, but like I've watched enough TV to know a little bit of something. Now, there's some shot callers. You know, some walk, they can walk to your office whenever they get ready.
Uh-huh.
They don't need no backup, no nothing. Just shot callers, you know. And listen, everybody know who he is, so they know not to mess with him.
Right.
You see, but if they didn't know who he was, and he was a shot caller, listen, let me tell you something. It'll be on him just like everybody else. You see, but Yahshua, You see, he was a shot caller, but he was hit.
Right.
They didn't know who he was.
That's right.
You said, read on.
That's right.
But as it is written, I have not seen,
read,
nor ear heard,
read,
neither have entered into the heart of man,
read,
the things which Elohim hath prepared
for those that love him. Man, listen. You don't know what you come unto.
Right.
You come to all there is to come to.
Uh-huh.
And let me say this. The purpose of the plan of Yahweh is complete.
Uh-huh.
If that was not so, we could not stand up here and talk about it.
Yeah,
read on.
But Yahweh hath revealed them unto us by his Spirit.
Now look, Yahweh has already revealed, listen, all the mystery. I'm talking about Yahweh himself is the mystery of mysteries.
Uh-huh.
And those mysteries have been unlocked.
That's right.
And revealed, because the seventh angel has sounded.
That's right.
And that was A.C.
That's
Kennedy.
That's right. That's
you see, I'm talking about in this age. You see, so we can know all the mysteries. Read on.
For the Spirit searcheth all
things. Now look, folks, it's that the Spirit searches something, and that the Spirit searches all things. Spirit is divine intelligence, wisdom and knowledge, love, beauty, justice, foundation, power, strength. These are only nine principal attributes. You see, and look, there are a multiplicity of attributes in each one of these attributes.
Uh-huh.
And listen, they are in you
right
now.
Right.
You see, read on.
Yea, the deep things.
Look, even look, Yahweh searches all things, yea, even the deep things of Yahweh. In other words, the thing of different, oh man, see, we go way back up in the realm of eternity. And we're looking at invisible principles, folks.
Okay.
We find out and understand the origin of the attributes. The origin of the man. The origin of your makeup.
That's right.
You see, we understand the origin of how eternity itself was created. I thought this is what we're talking about here. We understand how Yahweh takes on shape, form, and remains in an angelic invisibility. You see, how he remains there, yet reveal himself to a man when he see fit.
Wow.
Or when he feels like it.
Wow.
We're talking about Yahweh.
Uh-huh.
You see, and we also see how Yahweh manifests, listen, as the universe.
Right. Okay.
The angelic and the physical universe.
Uh-huh.
You see, and we also are able to go back into the realm of eternity and summons Moses.
Mm-hmm.
Summons Jeremiah.
Right.
Summons Adam. You see, some of us know we can do that right now in this age.
That's right.
If you understand.
That's right.
You see, read on.
But what man knoweth the things of a man,
read,
save the spirit of,
read
the
on,
man which is in him?
Read on.
Even so, the things of
now,
man.
Now, see, we can talk about Moses and the prophets all day and all
that's
night.
Right. That's right.
It ain't going to do you no good if you don't know what's in you.
That's right.
Huh. That's just an absolute fact.
That's right.
Because there's some folks to bring more knowledge than all of us in here put together.
That's right.
But they don't know who they are.
Right.
And if you don't know who you are, you are just a lost soul walking around in darkness. You see, what they call a soul, what they call a true educated fool.
Right.
We don't, can't tell you nothing about Yahweh and his purpose.
That's right.
Mention spirit, mention Yahweh, they start going on about and everything like they know because they got a PhD or a master and so on and so forth. Don't know a clue about what the soul is. Let's move.
Even so, the things of Elohim
know
no man,
read,
but the spirit of Elohim.
Now see, no man knows the things of Elohim, save Elohim himself.
Right.
Hold it right there. Let me have Matthew 11:25. Real quick.
Matthew 11:25.
Come on now.
At that time, Yahshua answered and said.
Now this is when he was walking around in the flesh. Okay? On the Palestine Judean hill. Preaching and teaching. You see, his boys that was gathered around him, just like Yahweh preached to these boys that was gathered around this tabernacle, just like Adam taught his kids, and Noah taught his kids. Come on now, read.
I thank thee, O Father,
read,
sustainer of heaven and earth.
Read on.
Because thou hast hid,
read on,
things from the wise and prudent.
Read on.
And hast revealed them unto babes.
Read on.
Even so, Father, for so it seemed good in thy sight.
Read.
And turning to his disciples.
Now look,
said,
here Yahshua, he turns to his disciples. Read on.
Unto me. And no man knoweth the Son but the Father.
Look, no man, look, no man knoweth the Son but the Father himself, who is the creator of all things, you will. Read on.
Neither knoweth any man the Father save the Son.
No man knows the Father save the Son himself.
That's right.
Which is Yahweh Elohim himself. He's running the show, whole show. He's a whole brass band by himself. Read on.
And he to whomsoever the Son will reveal.
And he to ever the Son will reveal. If you're going to know anything, it's because you got to go through the Son. Now, if you notice, I just put it down here.
That's right.
I said you got to go through the Son.
Right.
I'm talking about in you.
Thank
you see, because you got him.
Uh-huh.
You just don't know you have
him. That's right.
You see, because on the day of Pentecost, that's when Yahshua dispensed grace, man.
That's right. Uh-huh.
you see, and you being the bride, you see, of being fit to be in his kingdom, now you're one with him.
Right.
And he's translated you into that kingdom, you see, right. But he got a mystery, he got a purpose, you see, that is an operation. Read on, add a pattern, add a plan, let's read.
Come unto me,
read.
All ye that labor and are heavy laden.
Read on, now look folks, that's us, in this present kingdom age, in our ignorance, you see, in our darkness. And our stupidity, not knowing Yahweh as he really is and as he actually exists. You see, now we have an opportunity, you see, to know all there is to know about Yahweh and his purpose. Now, guarantee you ain't going to learn everything, but you're going to know enough, you see, to take you on into the next age. You are about an age to come, you see. Please, not in one of these, okay? Let's read on.
Take my yoke upon you.
Read.
And learn of it.
That's all you have to do. Just take your... Look, you ain't got to go get water baptized.
Right.
You ain't got to get circumcised if you don't want to. You see, you ain't got to have no Passover supper, no blood sacrifices, you see, and you ain't going to keep... Listen, you don't have to keep... You can't keep it anyway. But you don't have to make an effort trying to keep the law. You see, because you're gonna fall anyway.
Mm-hmm.
It was never given to you anyway.
That's right.
It was given to Jews and Jewish Jews only and not the Gentiles.
Right.
Let's read.
For I am gentle and lowly in heart.
Read on.
And ye shall find rest unto your souls.
That's all you gotta do, folks, is just learn about how he accomplished the service.
That's right.
And that will cause you rest for your soul.
Right.
Alright, now let's go back to Corinthians. I gotta move, I gotta go.
12:12.
Read on.
Now we have received not the spirit of the world.
Now look, we have not received the spirit of the world. Now we all been deceived.
Right.
Every last one of us in here has been deceived. And when you find yourself, you will find yourself in a fallen state.
Uh-huh.
What are you talking about? In darkness, in ignorance, you see, caught up in the flesh, you see, caught up in what you think is important, whether it be your kids, your money, your job, whatever.
Right.
That's what you're going to do. That's what's motivating you. You see, and what we're trying to do, you see, is turn your heart to the Father.
Uh-huh.
You see, through the preaching of the gospel, through the death, burial, and resurrection of Yahweh the Messiah, according to the scripture. You see, and elevate you out of the flesh. Read on.
But the spirit which is of Elohim.
Read.
That we might know.
Read.
The things that are freely given to us of Yahweh.
Read on.
Which things also we speak.
Read on.
Not in the words which man's wisdom teaches.
Read.
But which the Holy Spirit teaches.
Read on.
Revealing spiritual things to spiritual
Hallelujah.
Persons.
Now let's get one thing straight, folks. The Holy Spirit is not flying around someplace. You see, it's already in you.
Right.
You have to become conscious of it.
That's right.
You see, but if you ain't conscious of it, it's like you not having it.
Right.
You see, now let's just identify what the Holy Spirit is in a few minutes. Pick up the textbook. Read on. Keep reading here.
But the natural man
receiveth
not the thing.
Now, the natural man or the carnal mind cannot receive this.
That's right.
You see, like I was saying, when the first guys first came there, y'all see you read the Bible, do you know that water baptism is not, you ain't got to go through water baptism to be saved and so forth. That blew his mind because see, he understood the ways of the world.
Right.
You see, he was
right.
Raised up in Pharaoh's household.
Right, that's right.
You see, so that's all he knew.
Right.
You see, he didn't understand the flip side.
That's right.
You understand? Read on.
But the natural man,
read,
receiveth not the things of the Spirit.
They can't understand this. Why? Read on.
For they are foolishness unto him.
Read on.
Neither can he know.
Keep reading.
Because they are spiritually
discerned. And spiritually discerned. You see, now listen, I think I'll call the scripture real quick I want to go to. The textbook. I'm on the textbook. Real quick before I go to the textbook, let me have 1 John 2:26. Because I want you to understand, you have what you need right now.
Uh-huh.
You ain't got to give us no money to get it. You see, you ain't got to do no works to get it. You already have it. All you have to do is wake up and smell a coffee and start drinking. That's
right.
What you have to do.
Right.
Read.
1 John 2:26.
Read.
These things have I written unto you.
Read.
Concerning them that seduce you.
Read on.
But the anointing which ye have received
now look,
him
folks,
abideth in you.
This is the anointing that you receive.
Mm-hmm.
It's already abiding in you.
Mm-hmm.
You see? But you have to remove the veil.
Mm-hmm.
You see back here. You see, back under the dispensation of the law, you see, they had veils in this tabernacle. You see, but Yahweh, what he would do, he would raise the curtains, or he would raise the veil and reveal himself to a man like Isaiah or Ezekiel or Jeremiah, and then he'll bring the curtains on down. You see, because there was darkness, you see, from Adam all the way down to the cross. That's why the book says death reign from Adam on down to Moses. You see, although Moses died right here at age 120,
the dispensation of Moses was still going on down to the cross. You see, just like Adam died at 930 years, you see, but the Adamic dispensation was still going on. You know what I'm talking about? So likewise, the same thing is going on. So death ran from Adam on down to Moses. So they was in darkness. You see, and they was ruled by the night or by the moon. You see, because it was governed by that law. You see, and that law was a type of the moon. You see, and the moon ruled the night. So Israel was in dark. You see, and then here you come. You see, I'll get to that in a minute. Here you come, embracing that same old darkness. You see, being raised up in Pharaoh's household. You see, now let's read on. But you have the juice. I'm telling you that right now. Read on.
And ye need not that any man teach you.
It ain't me. Read on.
But as the same anointing teaches you in all things,
read.
It is true.
Read.
It is no lie.
Read.
And even as it hath taught you,
read on.
Ye shall abide in him.
Now see, folks, you got it. Don't make me know whether you accept it or not. You are Yahweh made manifest. You
That's
are
right.
Yahweh in the body.
That's right.
And you are what you've been looking
That's
for.
Right.
You see, if you're looking for Yahweh, hey, listen, here he is.
Right
within you. That's all you have to do is look for him. Listen, he is there, and listen, he will never leave you.
Right.
You see, but see, the problem is that you are all caught up in the flesh, in your thing, whatever that might be.
Right.
And what it is, your eyes been focused on something else and not on Yahweh himself. And that's what we're trying to do, is to elevate your consciousness. Now let's go to a textbook and identify what the Holy Spirit is, you see, and then I'm going to take a trip back up in this garden here.
Hallelujah.
Page 5, Volume 1. Yeah. Now you got to read quickly because I got to go.
Page 5, Section 2, Basic Scriptural and Scientific Preparation.
Read.
This divine revelation and vision, pictorially illustrated and explained herein, was shown to the writer by a great panoramic vision.
Read.
Which embraces the existence of the eternal Yahweh Elohim, his universal spirit law and purpose through the dispensations and ages.
Now when he says panoramic, that means that it's seen from all directions.
Right.
You see, every direction there is. It's being seen. That's the kind of vision Dr. Kinley had. It's the same one that Moses had. It's the same one that John had. Let's move.
Comparatively speaking,
read.
This is a new and revolutionary scriptural teaching which embraces the fields of cosmogony, anatomy, physiology,
read.
Psychology, philosophy,
read.
General science, and eschatology,
read.
To mention only a few.
Read. Now, in plain cornbread terminology, this is a school, not a church.
Right.
All right? Read on.
This teaching is spiritual.
Because you learn these things at school, right? You don't talk about those things in church, but this is a school. Mm-hmm. Read.
This teaching is spiritually transforming the carnal mind.
Now, look. Do you know what a carnal mind is? Romans 8:6. Hold it real close. Somebody pick it up real quick and just identify what a carnal mind is.
Romans 8:6.
Read.
For to be carnally minded is death.
That's plain. Right. We ain't got to go any further.
Mm-hmm.
To be carnally minded is death.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, you don't know.
Mm-hmm.
You're in darkness.
Right.
You see, what you don't know Yahweh's divine purpose and his pattern and his plan, because that's all that there is.
Mm-hmm.
You see, read on.
This teaching is spiritually transforming the carnal mind and illuminating the understanding of mankind in regards to this theological and religious concepts of Yahweh Elohim and his purpose.
So what we want to do is to extirpate current stupid superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. See, that's what we're doing through the preaching of the gospel.
Right.
In this school.
Right.
Let's move.
It teaches mankind according to the scriptures.
Read.
The truth about his origin and inseparable relationship with Yahweh.
Listen, folks, so what we're trying to do is to get you to understand your origin. Where you come from.
Uh-huh.
Now your destination is your origin.
Uh-huh.
You come forth from Yahweh. That's where you're going back. That's where you're going back to. And in reality, that's who you are.
Uh-huh.
You see? Read on.
Inseparable relationship with Yahweh Elohim, Yahshua, and the universe.
Now it says an inseparable relationship. You see, what the problem is that you think there's a you
right.
in Yahweh.
Right.
So some folks say, well, yeah, I know Yahweh's in me. But I'm not Yahweh. Because see, he's the creator.
Mm-hmm.
You see, but and I didn't create all this.
Mm-hmm.
That's what you said
mm-hmm.
out of your ignorance. You see, but the question, what I'm trying to get you to see, is the substance that makes you up this.
That's right.
Very much so.
You see, and that's who you are. You see, if you think this is you, that's a deception.
Wow.
You see, because when I'm talking about the flesh, please, I'm not talking about this right here. This don't make you do nothing, but it's what you entertain does. You see, and that is the reality. to get you to understand what reality is. You see, by replacing, but see, by replacing that carnality with reality, you understand the source of wisdom and intelligence and knowledge.
Right.
And then you learn how to execute it.
Exactly.
You see, through the preaching of the gospel, so you can have some peace.
Mm-hmm.
See, when you see all this chaos down there, you don't have no problem. So you know Yahweh is running the show. Because it was you who set up negative and positive.
Uh-huh.
You understand? Let's read, because I got to go. I'm running out of time.
See, the man is a part thereof.
Now, you know, the man, he's a part of that. Read on.
Do not be deceived.
Now, look, that's plain. I ain't got to explain that, do I? Read.
Moreover,
read.
This teaching is definitely supported by a divine pattern and plan.
Read.
Descriptively stipulated in the scriptures of the Holy Bible, it is discreetly confirmed by Yahweh Elohim himself. His incorporeal, visible and invisible,
read.
Universal creation, the line of the prophets, Yahshua the Messiah, the apostles, and in part by modern practical or general science.
Look, folks, Yahweh has given us witnesses.
Mm-hmm.
You see, he's given us the creation and all things therein. To prove his invisible existence.
Okay.
He's given us the law and the prophets as a witness.
Mm-hmm.
You see, he's given us a physical body as a witness.
Mm-hmm.
You see, there's no reason why you should not know your creator as he really is and as he actually exists.
Mm-hmm.
Because everything you see is him.
Right.
You see, everything you see and everything that you don't see, everything you know and everything you don't know, that is animate and inanimate is nothing more than Yahweh himself. Including you.
Right.
Don't exclude yourself from that. That's the deception.
Right.
You see? And that's what Dr. Kinley came to show us. Not that you got a satanic spirit in you,
mm-hmm.
But you're Yahweh made manifest.
Right.
You see? And you can point out the satanic spirit in anybody
that's
when
right.
you understand.
That's right.
Read.
That's right.
Likewise, this teaching exposes the adversary
who is
or false, the so-called occult.
How you going to do that? Because hold it right there. I don't mean to do that, but go to John 17 and 20. I ain't gonna get where I want to get you. Read on. John 14, 17, I think that's what I want.
14, 17.
14, 17.
The spirit of truth.
That's it.
Which the world cannot receive.
This is the spirit of truth right here. Yahweh Elohim himself.
That's right.
Read on.
Because it seeth him not.
Can't see.
Right.
Neither knoweth him.
Got you in the way. Your past. You see, some folks are gonna come down here because we don't have no choir. Don't you hear me? Not that we don't want one. We just ain't got nobody want to start one. But we love singing. Some folks won't come down here because they say, well, y'all don't pray enough. Now we get a little short prayer to get it rolling. We ain't going to pray for no 10, 20, 15, 20 minutes. You see, we're going to have no little session where we're going to pray for you, bring you on up here, and we're going to try to cast something. Like, we ain't going to do all that. You see, if the gospel don't do it for you, ain't nothing will. We're trying to get you to understand y'all and his purpose as he being formed in you. And if that don't straighten you out, it ain't no hope for you. Yo, the best place for you to do is to settle for the lake, and that's about it. Read on.
But ye know him, for he dwelleth with you and shall be in you.
Now look, he says you know him, but he dwelleth in you, and he shall be with you. Listen, when I walk, the Spirit walks. When I sit, the Spirit sits. You follow me? I'm telling you, you got that silent witness within you. You see? See, you are the observer, and you are the observer. And you are an extension. I'm talking about Yahweh himself. You see, you can't go no place without Yahweh. Come on. Read on.
I will not leave you comfortless.
And you know what, buddy? You know what gets me? Everybody. I'm going to tell you something. Folks to get up here and scream how they got a satanic spirit. And how the devil is, and the devil that, and the devil this, and the devil that, and the satanic spirit is, and the satanic spirit that. You see, as soon as you say Yahweh, they say, well, y'all, everything's Yahweh.
Uh-huh.
You say, hey, listen, including the devil. You see, my point is this, when you going to find out that you're Yahweh made manifest, man? Because that's who you're, that's your strength, that's your sword.
That's
you see, after you find out you're a satanic spirit, then what? The Holy Spirit going to come in you? Ain't no Holy Spirit popping in you. You must be crazy. Keep reading.
Yet a little while,
read.
The world seeth me no more.
Read on.
But ye see me, because I live, ye shall live also.
Read on. Look, folks. Remember he said, lo, I will be with you always. Even to the end of the age. Listen, man. Yahshua did not forsake us.
That's right.
You see, he is in his present kingdom age, running his purpose. Why? Because there's a pattern. The pattern is the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit in an abstract state. The pattern is the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit in an incorporeal state. And the pattern is the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit in a corporeal state.
Right.
You can't get away offering this bitch grace, the pattern came right with it. You see? And the purpose, you see, was manifested in you. You see? Because that's where he poured his spirit in the heart and mind of men. The spirit of truth. Read.
At that day, read. She'll know that I am in my
what father. Day? After the death, the burial, right. The resurrection, the ascension, and the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, whereby now the woman is now clothed with the serpent.
That's right.
You see? I'm talking about right now, folks. Read on.
That's right.
And ye and me, and I and you.
I and you, and you and me. Ain't no separation, because you have an inseparable relationship with Yahweh. Read on.
He that hath my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me.
Read on.
He that loveth me
Come
shall be loved
Read.
By my Father.
Read on.
And I will love him and will manifest myself to him.
That's good enough right there. I made my point. Let's go back and finish reading here.
Our aim here is to live.
Now this is the goal. That's why we're here. Sitting around, missing a football game, missing a basketball game, because we made a choice.
Right.
You see, choose you this day who you gonna serve. As for me and my house, I'm gonna serve Yahweh.
That's right.
All right. That's what Joshua told them when they came up.
Out of the
River Jordan. You see, and they took hold of their inheritance. And he rehearsed that event, how they came down from the land of Egypt,
right.
How they come to the divided wall of the Red Sea, how Yahweh roughed them up out here in the wilderness of Sinai, and they endured that, and how they came to the River Jordan, and he fought all that battle for them. But he said, listen. I've done all these things. Joshua
right.
says, I've done, I'm talking about a man.
That's right. That's
you see,
right.
located in the body, I'll
That's
come
right.
down.
Sure
you
is.
See? Mm-hmm. Read on.
Our aim here is to lead you step by step.
This is the goal. To lead you step by step to this
indisputable
becoming
indisputable. Profound knowledge
Read.
Of Yahweh, our Elder.
Read.
And a permanent conscientious
Look,
realization.
A permanent conscientious realization.
Right.
A permanent conscientious realization.
Right.
Read on.
Of his universal ever-present
Read.
In whom we live,
Read.
Move,
Read.
We have our being,
Read.
And a realistic and comprehensible understanding.
Now that's what the Holy Spirit is.
Right.
A permanent, conscientious realization
right.
of the Spirit of the living Elohim
Hallelujah.
In you.
Right.
That's the goal.
That's right.
Now that's why we're here.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Now let's go back up in the garden here. Exodus. Genesis 3 and 1. Matter of fact, let's go back to Exodus 24, 9 and 10, because I got a few minutes. I ain't got a whole lot of time.
Exodus 24, 9 and 10.
Mm-hmm.
Then went it Moses
Now look,
Aaron.
Here comes Moses, because Yahweh had commissioned him to go down to the land of Egypt. You see, and to confront Pharaoh. Now keep this in mind. Pharaoh's already set up.
That's right.
You see,
right.
Yahweh set him up. Look, he's the man down here in the land of Egypt.
Mm-hmm.
Nevertheless, he's in darkness. And look, and in his mind, it ain't chaotic.
That's right.
Right. I can't say what I want to say, but let me say, he's the hall. He's the man. I'm talking about Pharaoh.
Uh-huh.
He is the run of the show down here. And listen, everybody's bowing down to him.
That's right.
You see, I'm talking about down here, and look, and there was darkness down here.
Mm-hmm.
And listen, man, when Yahweh finished this thing, I mean, he devastated. He was chaotic.
Okay.
Yahweh showed him what darkness truly was.
Sure.
You know how we over there in Afghanistan
right.
roughing up their city,
that
country?
Yeah.
When it gets through, it's devastating.
That's right.
Same thing that happened in New York. You know, we saw pictures and things like that, but they say you can't understand
right.
what it really is like unless you was actually there in New York
right.
walking around.
Mm-hmm.
But when you look at Time magazine, it gives you more graphic illustrations of what really happened down there, where you see the arms laying around
right.
and the blood and so on, and you know and the fear and folks' pain. We see the nice part of it. Okay, let's read on.
Then went Moses and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu,
read
70
on.
The elders of Israel,
read.
And they saw the Elohim of Israel, and there was under his feet as it were paved work with sapphire stone.
Now let me say this, because I want to make sure I get this straight. Pharaoh is already down here.
Okay,
running the show. And he has Israel in slavery or in bondage.
Okay.
Now keep this in mind. Just like Yahweh Elohim took on shape and form,
mm-hmm.
or he was sanctified.
Mm-hmm.
You see, Yahweh separate in order. This is the son. This is Yahweh in a sonship degree.
Uh-huh.
Just like he told Abraham to get from among his kindred,
mm-hmm.
because his father was worshiping idols.
Mm-hmm.
Likewise, they was doing the same thing down here
mm-hmm.
in Egypt. Ain't nothing but idols down here.
Mm-hmm.
So now he's separating Moses. You see, out here, and appeared to him at the backside of his mouth in the burning bush. You see, now keep this in mind. Pharaoh is still set up right here because Yahweh also created Lucifer. I'm talking about when he was in his cloud.
That's right.
You see, and look, when he cast When he set the purpose in motion, he created the angelic host first. You see, and then he cast Lucifer out into ethereal darkness first.
That's right.
And I said ethereal darkness, that's a heavenly darkness. Mm-hmm. Come on, so what are you talking about? You know how Yahweh reveals something to you. You see it, you see it, you see it, you see it, you see it. Then when I get to you, you don't see it.
Right.
Now everybody in the room see it but you. Now, that's that darkness I'm talking about.
Right.
You see, and if any place Yahweh is going to, if the darkest place in the universe, and when I say universe, I'm talking about the angelic and the physical together. That's the universe, not just the physical thing. You see, in the man's conscious. You see, why? Because that's where Yahweh hides. That's where he hides himself. And then you run around here, looking at microscopes, trying to find Yahweh, up in telescopes, trying to find Yahweh, with both using hypnosis, trying to find Yahweh. You follow me? Going to, looking for fossils and so-and-so, trying to find something out about Yahweh. You see? And he's right here. When you move, he moves. Because it is in him that you live and move and have your being. You see, come on, let's read on.
And as it were, the body of heaven is clearness.
Read on.
And upon the nobles of the children of Israel, he laid not his hand.
Now look, here Yahweh, you see, he confronts Moses, tell him to go down here, confront Pharaoh. He confronts Pharaoh, and then Yahweh pour out 10 plagues. You see, the ninth plague was thinning black darkness. You see, now then, now, in that they were sitting in black darkness, that means there have to be a death next. You see, because they had turned dark on the face of the earth from the sixth to the ninth hour. You see, because as Joshua got on that cross, you see, it was going from light to twilight, and then there was darkness. You follow me? And listen, something's getting ready to happen. You see, because that was a phenomenal day, which I don't have to get into. But nevertheless, Pharaoh is set up down here, and now he's commissioned Moses to go down here and confront him. So you got unrighteousness and righteousness coming on down here into this darkness. You see, now there was light in Goshen down here, and there's Joshua down here, you see, with and Moses and Aaron when they get down here. Because there was always light in Goshen. You see, that would be a type of the righteousness or the light, and then there's darkness. Now, when he tells him, let the Israel go, of course Pharaoh said, I'm not going to do that. So Yahweh don't want to harden his heart. So listen, after the plague of death, there was an exodus out of the land of Egypt through the divided waters of the Red Sea, and they gathered around his mouth, and Yahweh was going to speak to him. Now he's not only speaking to his son, now he's speaking to his woman. You see, because now she is his bride. Now Israel is his bride.
Right.
You see, so he got to clean her up, and they're going to worship him around the earth. He's going to teach them about Yahweh, his purpose, by using his pattern. Right. He built his tabernacle pattern as a tabernacle of witness. That was built in the wilderness, and Israel's gathered around the tabernacle. You see, and they're learning all about Yahweh's purpose, similar to what you're doing right here. You see, we all gathered up, you see, around the mount, this mountain right here, learning about Yahweh and his purpose. You see, but it's done without hands, if you will. You see, they built this tabernacle and held enough blood sacrifices. Now, the blood shed is going to be the shedding away of that carnality that's here. You follow me? Nevertheless, he started calling Moses up in his mouth. You see, he told him to go speak to them, he speak that law. So Moses come up in his mouth to get that law. Now look, folks, when Moses get up in this mouth, Yahweh don't deal with the flesh. He blacks him out, and he deals with the essence that makes Moses up. What are you talking about? Divine intelligence, wisdom, knowledge, love, beauty, justice, foundation, power, strength. The man's makeup. That's what Yahweh is dealing with in Moses. You see, and listen, he becomes fused one with Moses. You see, and he shows him a rerun or a recapitulation of this purpose. How the creation, you see, that you live in comes in by the pattern of himself, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And when he comes out, when he appears to Moses in this cloud, or he appears within the cloud, it's not like Yahweh is over here, you see, and Elohim is over here. Mm-hmm. Man, where you take the pen out? Real quick here. He just appears to Moses in that cloud. Mm-hmm. Just like that. And listen, when Moses sees this, you see, and sees this, sees the creation being assembled by a pattern, the man Moses didn't have to remember it. He was made to know how the creation come in by the pattern of Yahweh Elohim.
Right.
You see, so that, listen, he is just writing like you would write in a book. He's writing it in his heart and in his mind. Mm-hmm. You see, so when he's seeing this, when he sees the creation being assembled, you see, there is something that's familiar to him. He's already familiar with the water.
Right.
You see, he's familiar with the man. You see, he understands all these idols down here. You see, he understands what fire and all this stuff is all about and burn.
Right.
He is familiar with the flesh or the physical. So now he's showing him the origin of the physical, of the flesh, just like we're showing you the origin of the man. So when Moses understands the origin of the flesh, he understands the origin of himself. You see, and that's what we're doing down here, showing you your origin by taking you way back into the realm of eternity and showing you how invisible principles operate. Now listen, when Moses gets up in this mountain, you see, he's seeing how Yahweh himself is manifesting in each day of his creation, separating the light from the darkness, the twilight and the mist. Now listen, this darkness that we're talking about, that is not satanic. You see, that is Yahweh's secret chamber, showing that the purpose is hid. You see, because the Lucifer, he is cast into ethereal darkness, listen, and he does not know the purpose. You see, and when the creation is coming in, you see, it's coming in perfection. You see, and listen, folks, what I want you to see is this. As Yahweh is taking on shape and form, a move from one state and condition to the next, you see, the purpose has to come with it. You see, so when he forms or creates or transmutes or transfigures into that first day, the purpose is encouched in that first day. Mm-hmm. You see, when he separates the light, the waters above and the water beneath, the firmament and the mist, you see, the purpose is encouched in that second day. You see, we're talking about the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and the divine service that's going on within that day. You see, on the third day, the water roiled the face of the earth, the seed of vegetation coming on up into the bud state, on into fruition, you see. The purpose is encouched in that day, you see. And likewise, the sun, moon, and stars being placed in the heaven, you see. And the seasons set in position. That is encouched in the first day, being governed, you see, by universal spirit law, you see, whereby the solar system is set in position and the planets orbit about each other, but they do not bump into each other because they're being controlled and governed by spirit law itself. And on the fifth day, he put the birds and the fish and the sea and the animals that cohabitate on land and water, but on the sixth day, he made the man. Now that's us, folks, and when he formed that man, you see, pick it up, Genesis 2:4, he formed him from the dust of the earth. Why dust? Because he's trying to show you the origin, you see, of the man. He's letting Moses know where he come from, how he got here. Just like we showed you where you come from and how you got here. He comes from the dust of the earth because it's the finer particles of the earth, the type of spirit.
Okay.
You see, right. So therefore, listen, I didn't say dirt, I didn't say mud, and I didn't say slime. I said from the dust of the earth, the finer particles. There's dust in this room. So he formed them from the dust of the earth. Read it. 2:4.
And Yahweh Elohim formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life.
Now look, he breathed into his life the breath of life. You see, real quick, Genesis 1:26 also.
And Elohim said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea.
Now look, he makes the man. See, there's so-called two accounts, you see, of the origin of the man. What she's reading right now is like a brief synopsis, you see. But what she read the first time was a more detailed explanation of how the man was formed. But what he actually saw was the same thing over. When he explained it a little bit different, in more detail. So he see how the man is made in the likeness and the image, and then he's placed in this kingdom right here. He said, or on the earth, if you will. In other words, Adam, you see, is placed in the land he knew not of, because he has to understand the origin, you see, of the man. So when you come in, you see, that spermatogenic fluid, you see, that cloudy-like substance, which is a type of spirit, you see, and as you come in, you're placed in a land you know not of, which is the earth. In reality, the whole earth plane is the garden. You see, when you understand, you see. So therefore, he's placed in the land he know not of. You see, and then Yahweh just steps in that man, just Yahweh just steps right in you. You see, that's a manifestation of Yahweh in the flesh, just like when you get here, as a manifestation of Yahweh in the flesh. Now listen, you are living. I'm talking about, listen, we are God and Adam. But right now, at this point, what I'm talking about, we lived in Adam before we died.
That's right.
You see, you are alive, I'm talking about in the flesh, man.
Mm-hmm.
You see, and Adam is in a heavenly state.
Uh-huh.
What are you talking about? Had no sin or no transgression happening
right.
on the earth at that time. And you are alive.
Right.
You see, and that is your origin.
That's right.
See, you didn't start off a devil.
Right.
That's right.
You see, you start off alive.
That's right.
In Yahshua.
Mm-hmm.
You see, and see, you being the woman was drawn out. You see, like the first speaker said, you can't do nothing to that baby until it comes out the womb.
Mm-hmm.
You see, So when a child comes out the womb, then you can start condemning him, don't you? You can start indoctrinating him, raising him up in Pharaoh's household. You know, you start learning the ways of, oh, yo, I know where each one of us, you know, have different principles that go on in our house. You see, that's how we grow when we develop, because see, as we all have, what goes on in your house goes on in your house, and so on and so forth. Then we all get together. We have different opinions about how we raise kids,
right,
how we want this built, how we want, you follow what I'm talking about? So this is being raised up in Pharaoh's household. You see, we all go through that. You see, so listen, here, but see, at this point, Adam ain't dealing with that. He's dealing with Yahweh, and listen, he's up in his garden, and all he had to do, he sat between those two trees, he just had to sit there and just dress the garden. Look at his woman. That's it. That's all he had to do. You see, eat any fruit he want. I'm talking about, look, the creation came in perfection. All he had to do is pick and eat. That's it. What do you do when you get here? Hey, you ready? When you get here, I'm talking about when you get here, hey, they ready, man. And all you do is you go from one breath to the other breath. And all of them, just eat all you want. You want to drink 5 minutes, you drink 5 minutes. You want to drink 15 minutes, you got 15 minutes. And when you fool, you just go to sleep. That's it.
That's it.
That's all Adam has to do. That's all babies do. They just sit here, and you know what we do? Oh, you look, that's such a beautiful boy. Mm-hmm. Such a nice little girl. Mm-hmm. Just sit here, you know what I mean? You know what we do? We go and buy expensive clothes for little kids gonna grow out of them in what? 2 weeks, 3 weeks. Child coming here weighing 7 pounds and 7 ounces. I guarantee you, by the time he's 2 months, he's gonna be like around about 14 pounds. You see, on 15 pounds and 6 ounces. Now you done wasted all that money, spent $35, $40 on a little outfit. You know why? Because you want to present him to the world.
That's right.
You know what I mean? Look what I did.
That's right.
Carter mine. You know what I mean? Like somebody care. Everybody got kids. You know what I'm talking about? That's why he started making the kids start wearing certain colors in the school, because he want to wear designer this, he want to wear designer this, say, hey, you know, black and white, or blue and white, you know what I mean? Everybody look the same, girls too. You know what I mean? That's what it's all about. So here come Adam, you see, in all his glory. You see, now here you come, in all your glory. You see, and you're being raised up in Pharaoh's household, and you start embracing those principles. Now look, keep this in mind, Moses was a witness to this, because he lived. You see, now he's caught up in the mountain. He is honest, he's delivered, he's bringing his Yahweh's woman, you see, out of this darkness, you see, brought her up in the woods, and now she's gathered around his mouth. You see, now Moses is a very proud man at this time, you see, because he done brought the son up, now they done married Yahweh. Mm-hmm. All the Yahweh say, we will do.
Right,
you see,
right.
So now they done just been given the law, and they know good and well, you see, that golden calf did not deliver them out of the land of Egypt. They also know it did not pour out those plagues. Because when they left out of here, Israel was devastated. I said devastated. You see, now listen. When they could get around his mouth, and listen, Aaron, he was responsible. But see, Aaron, he didn't know the purpose. See, Aaron was up on his mount. He saw Yahweh on him, but he did not see the tabernacle. So therefore, he didn't get no understanding. Oh, Yahweh didn't lay his hand on him. Please, I don't mean this. You see, he didn't give him no understanding. You see, he didn't give him no understanding. So therefore, he went on down here and listen. You know how peer pressure affects folks, right? You know, that's how games got started. You know, you follow me? So, in other words, if you're on a block, you see, and you ain't part of the game, you got a problem.
Yeah.
You got to figure out a way to survive. Likewise, you say they have an error. And they say, well, listen, Moses had gone up in this mountain. Been up there for 40 days. 49, we know he ain't took no food. He ain't took no water. He must be dead. Because this is a phenomenal cloud up here on this mountain. But this isn't like no any old cloud. It was a phenomenal cloud. And let me say this too. This cloud was not physical. This bush was not physical. It was phenomenal. You see? Now what are you talking about? You still in Exodus, right? Go to Exodus 6, go down to the 16th verse. I want to make a comment about that.
And the glory of God.
I want to make a comment about that because it's being taught now that this bush was physical.
Oh, no.
You see? And that when Adam, when Eve saw Lucifer, he was physical. It was not physical. It was not physical. You see? It was not physical. No more so than when you sleep in your bed at night. When you sleep in your bed at night, listen, folks, you are not conscious of the earthly realm.
You don't have a clue that you even alive. The only reason you know you're alive is Yahweh woke you up and said, hey, one more day.
That's right.
You see, now that is a spiritual realm. And that is what you call true darkness. You see, and listen, when Yahweh wake you up, it's the light shining in darkness again. One more time. You see, so if you want to know anything about inscrutability, that's it. When you sleep. That's the close, that's the only way I can make you understand that. You see, chaos. You see, indiscernible, inscrutable. And listen, in that state, when you're in that state, you don't see this until Yahweh start waking you up. When you start waking you up, then, you see, you come into that incorporeal state, you start dreaming. You see, you start seeing things, start understanding things. You see, and then you start, Yahweh start talking to you, start telling you things. You follow me? Sometimes when you're driving down the street, on the freeway, you know what I mean? Yahweh take you someplace else, and 20 minutes later, boom, next thing you know, you follow me?
Yeah.
You know how you got here, because you know you drove about 5-6 miles, and you didn't see nothing. Why? Because Yahweh is running the show up here. Now let's read.
And the glory of Yahweh abode upon Mount Sinai,
read.
And the cloud covered it 6 days.
Read on.
And the seventh day, he called unto Moses out of the midst of the cloud.
Read.
And the sight of the glory of Yahweh was like devouring fire on the top of the mountain.
In the eyes of the children of Israel. In the eyes. You see, in other words, in the eyes of the children of Israel, this is what they saw. Had you been there, you wouldn't have seen anything.
Right.
But in the eyes of the children of Israel, this was a phenomenal cloud. You see, in the eyes of the Egyptians, it was darkness, but it was light to the Egyptians.
That's right.
It was a phenomenal cloud, man. You understand what I'm talking about? We just know any old kind of cloud. This is a phenomenal thing going on right here. If I wouldn't know any old kind of bush.
Right.
You see, Yahweh is running the show
right.
when he's dealing with the man. Let's go back to Genesis. I got to move a mile of time here. I ain't getting nowhere. Just, you know what? Jump down to the third chapter because I want to make a point. I got to get out.
3 and 1.
He broke the race real quick.
Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field
Read.
That Yahweh Elohim had made. And he said unto the woman, Hath Elohim said, ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden?
Read on.
And the woman said unto the serpent, We may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden. But of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, Elohim hath said, Ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die.
Mm-hmm.
And the serpent said unto the woman, No death will you die. For Elohim doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as Elohim, knowing good and evil.
Okay. Read on. Now listen.
When the woman saw,
Hold. Now the deception is this, that when a woman protected the fruit, that she going to become wise. And look, she did eat. I ain't got time. But she thought she was going to become something she already was.
Right.
She already had wisdom.
Right.
You see, she ain't going to become wise. I mean, eat no fruit and get some wisdom.
Right.
If so, we all want the fruit, right?
Right.
You know what I'm talking about?
Right.
Anything that's good, we all want.
Right.
Okay, so therefore, that wouldn't happen. So that's the true deception. And look, the woman was deceived.
That's
okay.
Right.
I didn't say the man was deceived.
Right.
I said the woman was deceived.
Okay.
Adam knew what she was doing.
That's
he was
right.
looking right at her.
That's right.
You see, it's the same thing where, I'll go back here. Yahweh, if he did not want them to build that golden calf, he didn't have to let it happen.
That's right.
He didn't have to.
That's right.
But he allowed it.
That's right.
Why? There's a purpose in operation.
That's right.
You see, he going to take away the first that he might establish the second. You see, so therefore, when Moses sees this thing right here the first time, and he sees the woman drawn out, he comes down, he gets upset, wax hot, and break the table of stone. He did not see the transgression.
Okay.
Had he seen the transgression, you know what? He would have understood.
That's
what we're talking about the other night.
Right.
Was patience the other night. We're talking about patience. How do you get patience? Well, if you got love, you got patience.
Right.
Because now you understand why they're doing what they're doing out of their ignorance.
Exactly.
You see, and it's out of their ignorance is that Israel was doing what they were doing. Aaron did not see this. The first time or the second time. You see, so therefore, he participated in building that golden calf right there. You see, and listen, when they built that golden calf, and listen, Yahweh came down and took care of business. You see, nevertheless, before, when Adam was in this, when Moses was witness to this event, the woman being drawn out, keep in mind, when he's drawn out the woman, you see, he just manifesting on earth what was declared right back here in heaven. So just like Yahweh gave birth to Yahweh Elohim, you see,
And then Elohim gave birth to Virgin Mother Earth.
Right.
So therefore he's manifesting the same thing. He's forming Adam from the dust of the earth. And therefore Adam gives birth to that woman, drawing that creation right on out. What? There's a purpose. There is an operation. And everything is moving according to Yahweh's purpose. Because
right.
There's a pattern. You see? So therefore, listen, when he forms a man, he draws that woman out. You see? And if you notice here, you don't see no heart in that plate right there. Why? Because see, Yahweh, see, he's complete right here.
Uh-huh.
You see? But when he draws the woman out, they gotta come together.
Right.
You see? To produce a creation just like they were together all the way back here. I'm talking about male and female.
Right.
Male and female. Uh-huh. And male and female on the first day. What are you talking about? I'm talking about there's a greater light, there's a lesser light. Uh-huh. Light. Masculine, feminine.
Right.
Second day. Raging waters. Nice and small. You know how you want to take your girl out there? You know, just look at the water, watch the sunset.
Yeah.
Feminine, man. Third day, water, you know there's male and female with the plant kingdom.
Right.
You see, and then there's male and female. We just talked about here and here, masculine, feminine, on the fourth day. Mm-hmm. And then on the fifth day, bird, male and female. So when he makes the man, he better be male and female.
Right.
It has to be. It was purpose right back here.
Right.
Couldn't do nothing else but that.
Right.
Likewise, and I'm going to get down. You see, just as Adam is laying his life down for his bride, I said he laid his life down for his bride,
right.
Meaning this, he willfully partook of the fruit.
Right.
I say willingly, not that he was not, you know, he ain't over in the Taliban right now. Those guys are ready to fight, you see. But see, listen, he willfully, he knew what he was doing when he did it.
Right.
He laid his life down for his bride,
right.
Being obedient to death.
That's
likewise,
right. That's
Yahweh, in fulfillment, laid his life down for his bride, which is us. Meaning he's obedient to death.
Right.
You see, but he did it to conquer death.
Right.
He bring it to set death up.
All right.
You see, so now he's taking it up so that you will not taste death.
I ain't got a lot of time,
but I gotta go. You guys come back and visit. Come back and learn more about Yahweh and his purpose and plan. Hope you got something I was saying.
All the visitors for joining us today. It was a pleasure to have you here with us. We have classes here at the Ramada Limited on Thursdays from 7 p.m. to 9 p.m. and on Sundays from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. You all please stand to be dismissed by Rosemary Washington.
Come over here and say hi.